quiet, numbskulls. I'm broadcasting.
Hey, what's happening?
Brother, what's up?
This is a groovy party, man.
Yeah, I can dig it. Stop. Right on.
Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying.
I think anyone who puckers up their lips and presses it against their boss's buttocks and then smooches is an ass-kiss.
He's a font of misplaced rage. Name your cliche. Mother held him too much or not enough. Last pick at kickball, late night sneaky uncle, whatever. Now he's so angry. Moments of levity actually cause him pain. Gives him headaches. Happiness for that gentleman hurts.
All I'm asking is for you to just have the tiniest bit of vision. You know, to step back for 1 minute and look at the big picture. To take a chance on something that just might end up being the most profoundly impactful moment for humanity, for the history of history.
You're just absolutely right. And I'm absolutely wrong. It must be nice to always believe you know better. To always think you're the smartest person in the room.
This is your Are We Going Back to the Future? Leader Fan Radio Network,
excuse me,
and KFAN.com. 1 minute and 2 minutes and 3 seconds past the hour of 3 o'clock Central Daylight Time. Welcome back. It is a Thursday production of the Bumper to Bumper program on a increasingly sunny, looks like, and seasonable from a temperature standpoint, Thursday afternoon here in the Twin Cities of Minneapolis and St. Paul. My name is Dan Barrero, the host of the program, Sultan of Snark, the a-hole in the afternoon aardvark, and the beast. Gardzi is the producer of the program, as well as, quote-unquote, was sidekick now considered too demeaning a term for you individually or for all sidekicks collectively?
I have no issue with it. I can't speak for all sidekicks. I think that's what I am. I think that's what...
Is it too demeaning?
I don't think it's demeaning. I think it's a term of endearment.
It is, sidekick.
Yeah, this is my sidekick.
These cords are in the way here. All these Power Trip Morning Show cameras. Hold on a second. You speak for a minute.
Yeah, there's a lot of them, too. There's probably cameras in there we don't even know about. So you're moving the main camera and putting it back behind the monitor. Yeah, we won't need it.
Well, it gets away in the clock. Oh, the clock. Yeah. I like that other clock. I know there's one on our other screen, but it kind of keeps me. We're trying to create. We have, I think, done a pretty good job in the fan in recent years of creating some semblance of
clock discipline.
Clock management. Yeah, that's exactly it. And actually mastering it to a certain extent. And I don't want that to change at this late date. Bort and Volvo guest lineup today is pretty interesting. I think you'll enjoy it. Russo Radio, Wild, we're out at 6 today because the Wild wrap up a very disappointing regular season tonight. Is that correct? This is it. This is the final.
It's fan appreciation night.
Regular season game 2023-24, and we're not going to be in the postseason. That has been, of course, confirmed for a bit. So Russo we've kind of been doing postmortems with him lately and with Luigi, but this will be the I guess technically this can't be a postmortem because they still have to play tonight.
Right.
But I don't think it really matters much how it goes this evening. We'll get into some of what I want from Russo and really from the hockey community is convince me, the hockey ambassador, that there's any. I think I actually asked him this last week, but we'll get to it again because it's still salient. Is there any fundamentally sound reason to believe that next year will be fundamentally different?
Show us the hope.
Exactly. That's what we're looking for because we know we still have one more year in salary cap hell, right? That's next year.
Yep.
But that's not over until after next season. So that's where we'll start with him and we'll kind of go from there. Rumors are we might get a minute or two with Bill Guerin, the Wild general manager tomorrow. We're at least going to try. might be too late, busy day. I know he's going to be on with the Beyond the Pond crew. I thought I read that off of a Fallness tweet, okay. If I'm not mistaken. But we'll try to get him. If not, you know, they'll get him, and I'm sure they'll do a better job with him than I would anyway. But we do like chatting with Garen from time to time.
For sure.
So that's a hope for tomorrow. So we have a busy program tomorrow. Russo today is scheduled for 5:02. I mentioned we're out at 6 o'clock. Inbox is early today, which means you got to get to it because we're hoping to unveil the inbox at 3:30, bottom of this hour. Email Garzy, the sidekick, jg@kfan.com, jg@kfan.com.
There's room for you today.
I had a hunch there might be because we got to it late, and I probably didn't promote it early enough, especially when it's going to be on early in the show. And we had to move it a little bit because our other guest had some time constraints. He's in great demand today. He being one of the best music writers, pop music writers in the country by the name of Alan Paul, who's joined us for years and has written several outstanding pop music related books. A couple of them related to the Allman Brothers. I don't think there's anybody who knows that group better than he does. And we'll do Ode to a Dead Guy today. The news breaking that one of the co-founders of that esteemed band, anybody who's listened to this show knows it's one of my favorites, might well be my favorite, Dickie Betts, has passed away, I believe, at the age of 80 years old. He'd been in failing health, apparently, for a bit of time. And I believe now there is only one original member of the group left. I think it's J-Mo. I think that's the only one left of the group. I can remember when we oded Greg Allman, for sure. Dwayne Allman, obviously, has been gone for quite some time. Barry Oakley as well. So, in any case, Ode to a Dead Guy. Now, an interesting policy question that I meant to ask you and programming director Chad Abbott and even Bossberg that a texter has brought up. Would it be worth the potential FCC fine to play some of Dickie Betts' music with the Allman Brothers? And probably not worth the fine, because I guess the fine can be kind of hefty.
Yes.
But I'm going to see during a break if we can get any kind of dispensation that on the basis of, well, in this case, we're covering breaking news. Do the rules change about what you are able to play? And if I get the favorable answer, we'll try to include maybe one song. If we can't get two or three, like usually what we would do, we'd have several songs, right, over the course of the entire show.
Yes, we would.
But today, maybe I live with one if I can convince them or I can get a clarification on what the rules are when you're covering the news. The news is a musician has passed away. What is a musician known for? His songs, his music, right? And for me, it's the instrumental, I think it's the greatest pop instrumental ever done, a song called In Memory of Elizabeth Reed, and he wrote it. He co-starred in it, but he wrote it. So that'll be coming up at 4:15 or so this afternoon. With or without music, we will ode. And Alan Paul knew everybody in the band really well, maybe starting with Dickie Betts. He spent plenty of time with him. And in fact, Alan Paul's written two Allman Brothers books. And the last one we're going to refer to because there's a lot of stuff about his musical influence on the group itself, how tense things got because he split from the group for a long period of time, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm looking forward to that visit, even if it's for sad reasons, at 4:15 this afternoon. The Back to the Future part is a subject that we've explored from time to time before. I felt like we discussed it a lot during the COVID year. What was the COVID year? 2020?
Mostly, yeah.
Okay. And during much of the COVID year, we continued to come in to do the show. But it was a ghost town. This whole building, I would say, how many people do you think were in this building along with us in the height
in the building
of the COVID
or on
pandemic?
Our floor?
In the building. 10?
I was going to say over under 10.
Maybe 10.
Maybe.
Yeah, on this floor, zero. Other than us, it was you. Occasionally, it was just you and me. Correct.
A lot of times.
A lot of times. And at that time, we talked about rush hour didn't exist. Correct.
Right.
And we've got folks who I liken them to, you know, the the aging baseball player that thinks he should have made it to the majors.
Yeah.
And he still likes wearing the getup, still likes wearing the stirrups high, the whole bit, the whole, he's got the...
Yep, he's a ball guy.
He's a ball guy.
Yep.
You know,
you play till they take the uniform away.
Exactly.
That guy.
And some of those guys, you worry about a little bit because they tended to kind of take the whole thing a little far. But at least what they did, as far as I know, wasn't dangerous. But for me, another group that's kind of akin to that, sort of in, living in a fantasy world, refusing to accept that that was then, this is now, and you're never going to be. I mean, Corey Provis is never going to talk about you and rave about how you can go from first to third or your range at shortstop or whatever the case may be. Similarly, we had, what would the age group be? I would say, I'm guessing 20 to 50. Individuals who think they should have been great race car drivers if they'd just been given the chance. Way back when, it would have been the Indy 500. That's not so big anymore, right? Indy 500 has been completely
right.
supplanted.
NASCAR even so much. Now it's F1.
That's exactly
Formula
right.
Formula 1.
Exactly, Formula 1. And because the roads were so clear, they decided they were going to have road races. During the day, 394, 494. Hell, we talked to one of them.
He called in.
Got ugly.
As little self-awareness as I've maybe ever heard.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
Well, maybe it's just my bad luck, but I feel like they're getting braver again. Even though the roads are much more full than they were, they're not probably ever going to be as full as they once were pre-pandemic. But they're pretty well populated at this point. And now, twice this week, I've run into these clowns, not literally, fortunately, once on 394 heading in and once on 494 after work heading south. And I just shake my head because, look, a lot of people who drive are aroused by speed, right? I mean, it's kind of cool to go kind of fast and, you know, accelerate, get around somebody, that kind of thing. But most of us, I think, have matured to the place where we say, if we've still got that in our system, we got to do it someplace besides 394 or 494, right? It doesn't matter how good we think we are, how clever we are with a wheel, that we have greater maneuverability and hand-eye coordination than Paul Newman in his prime. Paul Newman, of course, big-time race car driver. Remember that? And the frustration is there's not much you can do about it, right? Because there's no even point in even calling, I don't know, Highway Patrol, because by the time you would call them, they'd be gone.
They're gone.
What are you going to do with them anyway? But are they coming back? Are they getting braver again? And what possesses people to have that little awareness? You use that term about the guy who called in, self-awareness, that you have the right to turn a major highway into your personal plaything, because they come in pairs or trios.
It's always a club.
Yeah, it's never one.
It's the racing club.
One guy, it's the racing club, and they pick the stupidest times to do it and the most dangerous times to do it. Who are these people, and what can we do about them? Is there anything we can do about them?
The only thing we can do is hopefully they get caught and hopefully they get cited for reckless driving, because that's what it is.
Is it evil and bad of me to hope that they get hurt without hurting anybody else? Is that wrong?
I mean, it's not the best ever, but I understand the instinct.
It's just because they're going to kill. I'd rather they kill themselves than somebody else. If you're asking me one or the other, that's what I would say. And I don't want anybody dead.
No.
Time for the let's give away some money. Maybe it'll assuage my concerns.
The fan and bigdeck.com. I'm going to give you a shot to put a grain in your hand with our national cash contest. And the first keyword of the afternoon is green. Go to KFAN.com and enter the keyword green.
Don't forget, Garzy, with he's in charge of the inbox. Email him. Still got time to get in. JG@KFAN.com.
If you want to win a VIP trip for two to Ballard's Resort, head over to our contest page. Enter to win a VIP package that includes two nights lodging for two and 2 days of guided walleye fishing. KFAN.com, keyword contest to enter today.
Regarding the racetrack wannabes, the what is number one right now? Formula One? Is that the?
Yeah, I think so. F1.
F1, is that what they call it in the business?
Kids love F1. It's big time.
I say there's that many, but there are enough idiots who they're in some midlife crisis, or they're not capable of accepting that they're never going to be on the oval to win anything significant. So they say, well, I'll just pretend, but I'll use our highways to do it. Interesting theory has been advanced via the Bradshaw and Bryant KFAN text line. They're all Democrats, Dan. That's what Zach thinks.
Really?
Zach has concluded.
The libs.
That they're the libs. It's the libtards, as they call them in the business.
I didn't realize.
How do you figure that out? Do you know? I mean, how do you go about coming to that conclusion?
Maybe they have some bumper stickers on the cars that you can...
They all say, we're for Sleepy Joe?
Yeah, they can glean.
Is that what it is?
Probably, yeah.
Curious, hit the text line if you have observed these individuals. And again, you can't chase them. You're not going to win that. You can't follow them. I mean, I don't think there's... a hell of a lot that you can do, but it's just maddening. And it's, like I said, it's twice this week that this has indeed taken place, unfortunately. And it worries me.
I think tonight on the way home, if we drive next to each other, which sometimes happens.
It has happened from time to time.
We live relatively close. If I see the Borton Volvo electric SUV in front of me, I think I'm just going to buzz you like I'm Tom Cruise. just do a flyby. Yeah. See if my Honda Accord still got some juice left in it. See if I can do it.
What do you make of this text? James writes, I think if you asked my wife and likely other people's wives as well, you might find that they think we all drive, that we all drive like these individuals. Well, yeah, I know that happens. And there's definitely Larry Lane change guy. There's, you know, the people who are constantly trying to take advantage of really small openings on the road. It's almost like that's a challenge and that's the game for them. And that's annoying too and potentially dangerous. But this is a horse of a different color to me, to mix metaphors, because this involves, like I said, general at least two, sometimes three or four vehicles. And so whatever one person can do to cause damage, does it not increase? I think Mike Bryant of Bradshaw and Bryant would suggest the analytics say your chances for trouble and danger go up exponentially if you've got three clowns all thinking it's their highway, that it's their road at the same time, chasing each other, going around this lane, going from right lane to left lane, back and forth, etc. I mean, the fantasy would be, obviously the perfect fantasy is a cop's around, which never happens. The second best fantasy would be they can't get around like two vehicles. They suddenly just find themselves sort of penned stuck, and they can't do anything, right? Now, we've got cameras everywhere, right? I know
that's
all
what
over 384, 484.
Yep.
So can you be, I mean, is that stuff taped? In other words, Are there any monitors, hall monitors, who are watching those tapes or watching in live action? And if they spot those individuals, can those individuals be ticketed after the fact?
I would think yes. There's a lot of states where they record you from point A to point B. And if you've gotten there too quickly, they'll cite you for speeding. That happens, right? We get that. You'll see those signs that say...
Right.
You know, radar enforced, or, you know, we're watching you from afar, whatever it is. I would think, yes, you could if they see completely reckless driving like what you're talking about. And it definitely happens out west, like you said, 394 out to Highway 12, I think.
Right,
which
definitely.
Is not a great place. I mean, once as the further west you get out, especially when it goes down to two lanes, that's what they were doing.
That's exactly
That was this club, the West Metro Racing Club, or whatever they called themselves.
Is that what they were?
They had a name.
Well, had they been written about?
Yeah, that's how
we got into it, and then then one of them called in.
One of them called in. He was like 24 and basically said, I don't care.
Yeah, I don't care.
He's like, I mean.
Is he dead?
I don't know.
He died?
I haven't heard from him.
Okay.
It was a remarkable discussion because he had no idea why anybody would be perturbed that these individuals were doing this.
Well, again, there's the danger it creates, but you know me. For me, as much as that, it is the self-awareness issue. It's just it's my road. People who are so self-absorbed about living their fantasy, and it's a fantasy, again. You're not going to be a great race car driver. It's just a stupid, invented fantasy that they can't see past it. It's that attitude, which is a large part of the reason why the world is screwed up in the first place. Now, texter guy here says, I'm going to need some help from you on this. Let's see. I don't know that I will, but I'll read it. I'll read it in a way that I'll play dumb. This is from 7th Floor Ramp A Guy. Dan, these street racers have a complex known as SDE, the antithesis of BDE.
Oh, boy.
Ask Garzy for BDE definition. Now, as it turns out...
You don't need my help.
No, in this case, I've learned it.
Okay.
Because I don't think it's a term for my generation.
No.
It's a term, is it from your generation or even younger?
Probably a little younger.
Okay.
Probably a little younger.
I'm guessing in our audience, well, it's easy to look it up. You Google it.
Yep.
And you're not going to get in trouble for Googling it. It's not pornographic. I mean, it's a little rough in the language, but you get the, I think, I'm guessing 80% of our audience knows what BDE is. Don't you think? Or is that high?
It's probably a little bit high.
Think that's a little high?
Probably a little bit high.
Okay.
But the emphasis here...
But instead
of the big energy, which we're talking about here, as he said, it's these drivers have, they think they have BDE, but they actually have SDE.
Which would be the opposite.
Correct.
Small. Of BDE.
As opposed to big. When it comes to the D energy.
Yeah. And that's one of the things I learned was that it really isn't about biological size. It's about size in terms of attitude.
Exactly. Right? The energy.
Yeah, exactly. It doesn't have anything to do necessarily with whether Pat Kessler actually had reduction of this particular organ yesterday, as was suggested at the start of his segment.
Correct.
Nothing to do with that.
Right.
Libs, a couple people, one texter saying they drive Priuses. Do they? I don't know. Some do. I don't think all do, though. I think some libs, maybe guilty about it, still end up enjoying their privilege enough to drive fancier cars. I don't know. But it would be, I would assume, hard to get in any of these sorts of races on 394 and keep up in a Prius. Is that fair to say?
It depends on the Prius.
Does it?
I don't know. Who knows? I've never driven a Prius. I don't know how fast it goes 0 to 60 or 0 to 110. Yeah.
We don't have... We don't give out issue. If we ever did, we don't issue tickets on the basis of traffic cameras, do we? Like,
I don't believe we do.
Was a time, there are places where, you know, if you don't stop on red or you go against traffic, whatever, you can get just on the basis of a camera.
Yeah, they'll get a ticket with a
picture on it. You end up getting a ticket in the mail.
Yes.
I don't think we do that anymore.
I don't believe we do.
Did we ever?
I don't think so.
Not sure. Dan, this is Kyle from Baxter. I just recently moved from 218 to the 763, as they say in the business. And everybody I told that I was moving had the same reaction. They gave me a weird, disgusted look and asked me why I would move back to the metro.
Wow.
I have plenty of reasons, but it's stuff like this and these kinds of stories/events to keep the sentiment going. Ever since COVID, people still view the metro as bad. Well, yeah, and that's, as we've discussed, that's too much of a generalization. For my liking, it's a lot more complicated than that. And I'm not sitting here pretending that every day this stuff's going on the highway. I don't know how often it's going on. Maybe it's bad luck that I've run into it twice this week. But even when you see it once, it's just infuriating is what it is. And I maybe the mistake is bringing it up publicly, because then maybe for the people who are so self-absorbed, all it does is encourage them to say, I know when he leaves the station. You know, I'll try to time it to try to get him going. I hope people don't do that, but some people are immature enough to do that, correct?
If you push the wrong button, yeah they'll do it just out of spite.
These are often very expensive vehicles, correct?
Yes.
So I think that's the comeback. The comeback is, well, if I'm gonna spend $180,000 on a vehicle,
got to open it up.
Got to open the damn thing up. No, you don't. Go find some closed track to do it and knock yourself out. Hopefully, literally, hitting a guardrail. Just leave the rest of us, please, leave the rest of us alone. Scott from St. Paul, from 95 to 2000, I worked security at North Star Steel, located at Highway 61 and 494. On the west side of the mill, Barge Channel Road, every Friday and Saturday night, every day people would have drag races with many people watching. Just an FYI. Well, that has become a complaint. I don't know how current it is, but post-COVID, there was that complaint. Street races taking, just breaking out in metro areas, right? Including sometimes downtown Minneapolis, sometimes downtown Chicago.
That's right.
I don't know if that's still happening, but yeah, it would just be just basically driving in circles as fast as you can, creating sparks, just stuff that I guess arouses people. I don't know. Does it arouse you?
Not even a little.
Yeah, I didn't think
of that. Thank you for asking.
Dr. Dan's inbox is right around the corner. We got a heck of a program. Russo Radio on a Minnesota Wild post-mortem. He is scheduled for 5:02. We will not ignore the Minnesota Timberwolves today. We're inching closer to game one on Saturday on the Fan. Obviously, the Wild's final game will be on the Fan this evening as well. That's why we're out early at 6 o'clock. And we will indeed ode the great Allman brother, Dickie Betts, who's passed away at the age of 80 years old, with really the unofficial biographer of the Allman brothers, a great writer by the name of Alan Paul. He'll join us at 4:15.
Schlesinger headed to the Orpheum Theater. You can catch her on the Get Ready Tour when she comes to town Friday, August 23rd. And tickets are on sale now. Head over to KFAN.com. Keep your calendar for more info.
Now, speaking of bumper music, we have received permission from the corner office, or one of the corner offices, to later play a couple of Allman Brothers songs written by Dickie Betts. So we'll put that into the mix a little bit later. So apparently they're willing to pay the fine. I think they buy the notion that you're covering the news of an iconic artist's passing. Therefore, a little bit more leeway will be understood and expected. For you Allman Brothers fans out there via the Bradshaw and Brian KFAN text line, 64686, give me your nominations. If we're going to play, let's just say, to keep it cautious, two Allman Brothers songs written by Dickie Betts. What would you vote for? 64686 is indeed the number. Russo Radio will join at 5:02 today. We're out early as for Minnesota Wild Hockey. The final game of the regular season is tonight. Inbox is now, and again, sometimes even during the episode, Garzy is able to implement nimbly a couple of extra bonus items, so don't hesitate to get something down quick and email him, jg@kfan.com.
It's time for Dr. Dan's Inbox.
Letters. Oh, we get letters. We get your letters every day.
Dear Dr. Dan, it was great to spend some time up in Minneapolis the last few years, but now I've gone a little bit further south, and I like it down here. Throwing the ball well, and here's the big thing. My team is hitting above the Mendoza line. Ooh. You may think that's not a big deal, Dr. Dan, but my former team, your squad, as a club, is hitting 193. Money aside, would you want to pitch for a team hitting 193? I certainly don't. Good luck finding a second starter up there, Dr. Dan. Please say hi to P. Lopez for me. S. Gray.
S. Gray, I don't believe, has given up a run yet. Now, he started the season, I believe, on the IL. Because he pulled a hammy or pulled a muscle. Something happened.
He's recovered.
And people were saying, well, you know, Dan's what do you think goods. Of him now? Yeah. He's come back nicely. You know, and here's what's interesting. You know, we had R. Baldelli in studio over the summer, and we talked a little bit about the loss of S. Gray. And people in the know claim that even if the Twins had made a concerted financial effort to get him, that he wasn't going to stay here. Now, that may be convenient to take the heat off. There might be some truth to it. I didn't like that we made really, didn't sound like we made any effort. But did I, more specifically, underrate one other possibility beyond whatever concerns he might have had about the offense? Although I don't even know he could have predicted the offense would be this bad or this injured this early. The fact that he and R. Baldelli went at it a little bit about getting pulled. Remember? Now, my recollection was last year, he pitched as long as he wanted.
Yeah.
Forever.
It was more the year before, right?
Right.
Yeah.
But it was C. Provis who, in an in-studio visit, reintroduced that subject. Now, he didn't say flat out he thinks that ended any chance, but he did bring it up. So is it possible that was that my swing and miss when R. Baldelli was here was to only talk about the second year and not so much any baggage left over from clearly what was frustration on the part of S. Gray? And so maybe that was a bigger issue. If you're S. Gray and you have options.
Yep.
You may not despise the current manager. You may even think, okay, he got it. Second year, he let me go as long as I wanted to. But it still stuck in my craw a little bit. I didn't like the feel.
He still probably had to fight for it more than he thought he should have.
And so he said, well, why do I need to do that when I don't need to do that? When I can go to a great baseball town.
Great ball town.
Unbelievable. Almost as good a baseball town as Indianapolis is a sports hosting town.
Almost.
Close. And I'm just wondering if that has been perhaps a little bit underreported. Regardless, he's off to a magnificent start, and regardless, we haven't replaced him. None of the guys what did R. Baldelli say here? Well, you know, you can't really replace him with one, but maybe you can replace him with two or three.
Like Paddock.
But most of the two or three that we're looking at so far have not been very distinguished.
Frustrating. Real frustrating.
Good baseball.
Letters. Oh, we get letters.
We get your letters. Dear Dr. Dan, we were hurt by your criticism of our regular season finale to the P Suns. Let us explain it to you, superfan, in layman's terms. Dr. Dan, we knew we were playing the Suns in the first round of the playoffs, no matter what. As either the 2-7 or the 3-6. The odds told us that. So that's why we didn't want to show our playoff opponent everything we had for them.
Okay.
You'll see it was a genius approach. Some might even call it, Dr. Dan, the long game. C. Finch and M. Norrie.
Huh. By the way, we found out yesterday from S. Mitchell that Norrie worked with him. He worked with him in Toronto, which I guess I had forgotten. I didn't know. Anyway, that's an aside. Well, the cliche in football was always, we don't want to show a team we're going to play in the playoffs everything we can do, right? If we happen to meet in the regular season, certainly in the preseason, you don't show anything to anybody, right?
I don't think so.
Maybe we'll look back on, after the Wolves sweep the Suns, maybe we'll look back on, they're playing possum. They had all kinds of ideas on how to play these guys. They just didn't want to show it. They didn't want to give Phoenix a head start. They didn't want to give Frank Vogel, their head coach, a head start to basically countermeasure our first big counter move. Not sure I buy it. I think the other thing you have to remember is we've got all these days of practice, right? You can't really solve everything in 3 or 4 days of practice, I don't think. I don't, because you're not playing the Phoenix, you're not playing the P Suns in practice, right? So the best you can do is come up with some alternatives, come up with some different ways to play. I hope even some different combinations, and just go about the business of not turning the ball over as recklessly.
That'd be helpful.
As we did in our most recent game. I think you said the odds makers still have the Suns as a slight favorite. Is that correct?
I think so for the series. I'll look. We were favored by a point
game
and
one,
a half.
Right? Yeah.
Game one.
So yep. That they may be throwing us a bone. I saw Star Tribune. I don't think it was Chris Hine. I think it was my guy, Jay Zagoda, did the prediction, did the analysis of the series and the prediction. You care to predict what he predicted for Wolves Suns?
Suns in six.
Exactly right.
Is that what he picked?
Suns in six.
Believe.
Too much firepower, and they're getting hot at just at the right time.
It's possible, having watched the game on Sunday, that overconfidence is the Suns' only enemy. Because they're feeling good about themselves.
They are feeling very good about themselves.
They were feeling footloose and fancy free on
Sunday.
Well,
the thing I didn't know until I read that particular piece, I knew Phoenix had a good offense in terms of efficiency. But they're like, I think they're ranked like 13th defensively, which is a little higher than I thought they'd be. I think they're 8th best offense, 13th best defense. Now, that's not great, but it's kind of balanced. Yeah. You say, well, there's not a great disparity. And that's been the one difficult challenge for the Wolves. The one hesitation about proclaiming them having as good a chance as anybody going the distance is we've tended to be number one in defense and like 16, 17, 18
correct
in offense, right? And I don't know if we moved that up at all lately. At this point, it doesn't really matter, but the offense is obviously going to have to improve somewhat.
It's time for Dr. Dan's Inbox.
Letters. Oh, we get letters. We get your letters every day.
Dear Dr. Dan, I've had more time in recent years. I've been listening to a lot of podcasts as well as appearing on a lot of podcasts. And I have to say I'm flummoxed by what's coming out of Minneapolis and St. Paul. Why would the Vikings use all those draft picks to trade up in the first round, let alone the top five? When everybody knows, Dr. Dan, trading down in the draft is the answer. Imagine what pick 11 could turn into. Imagine then what pick 23 could turn into. We're talking 4, 5, 6, maybe 7, 8, 9 late round draft picks, Dr. Dan. I'll remind you, Tom Brady was a 6th round draft pick. Are we looking at this the wrong way?
God.
At my former employer, sincerely, R. Spielman. R. Spielman.
I was worried that might be K.A.
Mensa?
Mensa.
Could be. Because we have some letters written for
him. He's got a little of that propensity himself. I think this year's going to be different. Yeah, I don't think this is a year where we have to worry about us moving down, following the R. Spielman dictates and moving down to maximize. I think they know this year is about getting a quarterback, being committed to the bit on getting a quarterback. The question is going to be, again, how much you're willing to give up, and are you going to have to beat the Giants to the punch if, as many believe, the Giants are coveting JJ. The other interesting nugget we got from Sievert yesterday is the people who cover the Patriots are convinced that, yes, the New England has the number 3 pick in round 1, that the pick is gettable, but that the Patriots want a player, like they want an existing National Football League player as part of that package. They're more interested in that than they are a bunch of draft choices. So, again, given how few players the Vikings can afford to give up, you're not going to give up JJ. Would you give up the left tackle, Darisaw? I don't think so.
No.
To move up? Does that take away? Because I think some people are, God, that's kind of intriguing. You know, New England, they might be there. They got so many needs. But if those reports are true that New England, for whatever reason, has said, no, if we're going to move out of this pick, we want a player already established in the league, I think that takes away the chances that the Vikings can meet that particular demand.
It's time for Dr. Dan's Inbox.
Letters. Oh, we get letters. We get your letters every day.
Dear Dr. Dan, I don't know why everyone keeps talking about the Vikings trading up to get a quarterback or which quarterback they should take. I may not have had the best stats so far, but then again, Dr. Dan, I've never been on a team with such a calculated and positive culture and coaching staff. Cato Famenza said, I wasn't signed to be a bridge quarterback. I'm here to be the quarterback of the now, and I intend to be the quarterback of the future. As long as there are no ghosts I can see at U.S. Bank Stadium, which has been an issue for me in the past, someone please show me some love and hope they draft players to help me in the first round instead. S. Darnold.
Are we sleeping on S. Darnold? That's the question.
I'm not sure. I don't think we are.
Well, if you use the infrastructure theory, I mean, there are some people to this day who think that T. Lance might have a chance. You know, if you give him the opportunity. There are people who say some of the quarterbacks, including S. Darnold, had been drafted by more accomplished teams with greater infrastructure, that they would look better than they have. In fact, he didn't look horrible in limited minutes with what team last year? The 49ers.
That's true.
So, we're going to find out. I don't think there's any question we're going to find out, right? I mean, I will be gobsmacked no matter who the Vikings end up with in the draft from a quarterback perspective if season opener, it's not S. Darnold on the field. And look, he does have some people around him. He obviously has J.J. And seem to be, I think, greater and greater indications that any of those contract crisis concerns might be unwarranted. We'll see how that plays out in the coming weeks. We still got people. Paul wants to trade J.J. to the Patriots for the third overall and the Patriots' first rounder in 2025. And that might be a high first rounder. That tempt you at all? You get your quarterback that you want. Then you get to choose. You don't have to pick fourth or fifth or sixth. You're now picking third. And you're getting a bad team's number one next year as well. But you got to give up J.J.
I don't want to give up J.J.
I don't think I do either. Not yet.
I'm not on the give up J.J. bandwagon. Dr. Dan, all the ayahuasca and darkness retreats have given me the epiphany that no other 40-year-old football player has gotten. I say this fully admitting that I have no medical training, and this has been mostly fueled by what I've read on the internet and conversations I've had in the echo chamber of my life. HIV and COVID were both created by A. Fauci and the U.S. government to make money. I don't know why people continue to put a microphone in front of me and let me get away with saying this stuff, and that they're paying me to say it, but it is funny. Best regards, A. Rogers.
Yeah, he, what was that, a podcast? The most recent salvo?
Like,
I don't know which one it was.
He's always in a room with a microphone.
Yes.
And he's always got his hair a certain way, or he's wearing his hat.
And he's always saying, yes, I know I'm not an epidemiologist. Yes, I know I'm not a scientist, but I can read. I can research. I can look stuff up. It's where he's looking it up, of course, that might end up being part of his issue. Dr. Dan fondly remembers that, what was it, 24-hour brush fire? Was it 36 hours? In which A-Rodge was going to be RFK Jr.'s running mate.
Yeah, that was fun.
Remember that?
Yeah.
That came and gone. It came and left pretty quickly, didn't
it? I kind of like that.
But, I mean, it's over now, right? There's not a, the funny thing about that period was how hard reporters felt obligated to actually say, this would kind of be challenging to be the quarterback of the team and to campaign for vice president of the United States.
You would think so.
As if the obvious actually had to be stated out loud. But it came and went awfully fast. Who else? Jesse was on that list.
He was.
Now he's off. By the way, he named somebody, didn't he? I don't even remember. I think Kessler told us.
Yep.
Somebody not quite as high a profile. So we'll all agree that was all. I can't even use the term I want to use for it. That was all invented, contrived, made-up nonsense just to get RFK Jr. in the news and to give those of us whose job it is to talk about meaningless stuff a chance to talk about something that meaningless.
The government really lives rent-free in A. Rodgers' head.
No question.
He's got a lot of problems with the government.
There's no doubt.
Got a lot of problems.
It's time for Dr. Dan's Inbox.
You know what? If you don't like it here, move.
Love it or leave it, man. Love it or leave it.
Why does he hate America?
I don't know. Anyway. Dear Dr. Dan, I was so sad and a little disgusted last night as I watched the final A Coyotes game in the state of Arizona. The fans looked so sad. The broadcasters looked so emotional. The players did their best. But they're still moving to Salt Lake City. As the hockey ambassador in the state of Minnesota... Yeah. Are you as disappointed as I am that Arizona ownership has decided to sell and make this move? Sincerely, N. Green.
Is N. Green still alive? I assume he is, because I think we would have known if he passed away.
Yes.
I'm not going to lie to you. The hockey ambassador was suffering from some flashbacks yesterday of going down to Met Center, hanging out with the Zamboni guys, writing a piece about, you know, the little people. You know, the people who made everything work at a place like that, who didn't get the big headlines, but who were utterly and completely invested in it. I did think a lot about that. I remember covering the last, you know, few home games there as well, the weirdness of the situation. I haven't studied, I do know this, and we'll talk to Russo in about an hour. My feeling is that the handwriting has been on the wall for a long time, right? That for whatever reason, it just wasn't working in Arizona, correct? And it was just a matter of where the team was going to land. So, but yet I know at the moment of truth, there's still a great deal of wistfulness. There's a great deal of nostalgia. And you almost make it seem that the team was in a better position than it really was. Just out of emotion, you know, of the moment. Because it's never, what's the word I'm looking for? It's never fun. It's never joyous to have a team leave your town. Even if you think they didn't have reason to do it, you feel, if not betrayed, you feel unwanted. You feel like they don't like me. The opposite of what Sally Field said when she won the Oscar, right? You feel like, well, God, what is there? And then deep down, you start wondering, what's wrong with us? Is there something wrong with us? So you get maybe the anger of, well, not our fault. But deep below that, I think, is that, God, that doesn't happen very often. What do we not do? And then you start saying, do I want to be a part of this place?
Right.
And then before you know it, you've moved to Salt Lake City. Well, that might be a bit much to expect.
I wouldn't move from Scottsdale or Tempe or Mesa.
Salt Lake City's beautiful this time of year.
It's nice.
Well, it's pretty. They get the Wasatch Mountains in the background.
Mountains
it's a beautiful
are nice.
Backdrop.
Good lake.
Very true.
It's a salt lake.
I think that's what they call it.
Do a couple walk-offs here.
It's got time two of them for you. Dr. Dan's Inbox.
Letters. Oh, we get letters. We get your letters every
Dear Dr. Dan, before you judge speeders, it's important to consider the driver might have a medical emergency, human or canine.
Oh, my God.
Jay Addison. Dear Dr. Dan, I think I made a mistake. I should have corrected my vision first before I went through with the reduction. It's all about the wiener, P. Kessler.
That's a callback to yesterday's return to the program of P. Kessler. First to discuss a penis reduction procedure, then to talk about having some cataracts taken care of, which ends up being more the real story. But we've never, when it comes to the wiener, we've never let the real story get in the way, especially as it pertains to Special K.
It's all about the wiener.